Welcome to the Wine and Vinyl Club, a podcast for people who like to drink and listen to great music. Once a fortnight, Chris, David and myself, Christian, discuss an album from an eclectic mix of classics and favourites through the decades. We'll then attempt to match it with two different bottles of wine or something a little bit different and finally choose our favourite to enjoy while listening to this album. We hope you enjoy it.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Wine and Vinyl Club, the show about wine and music and the matching of it. David, tell us what we're listening to.
Okay, today's album is Fine Line, a veritable smorgasbord of Harry's styles. It was released 13th of December, 2019. The label was Columbia in America and Erskine Records in Britain. Producers, oh, there's too many to mention. Number of tracks, it had 12 tracks, a length of 46 minutes, 37 seconds, and the genre was pop, and it included elements of prog pop, psychedelic pop, folk, and indie pop.
Cool. And the wines this week, we've got two, and this week I will be providing one, but Christian will be providing the other. So, Christian, tell us about wine number one.
Look, I went to California, gone to Sonoma County in California, and I've gone to the winery that belongs to Francis Ford Coppola. Is that how you say it? Coppola? Coppola?
Sorry, I got a mouthful of cheese.
I think it's Coppola. It's the 2017 Director's Cut Zinfandel.
Looking forward to it. Well, I went in a completely different direction, and with this album, I've selected a rosé, which is 100% Shiraz. We can talk a little bit about rosé later on in the show, and it's from Golden Mile, which is in the Mclaren Vale, which is South Australia. It's approximately 13% alcohol, and when you guys get to see it, you will see exactly why I have chosen this wine for this album. All right, Dave, tell us about the album.
I already hinted that it is a smorgasbord of different styles of music. You could say it's about love, it's about breakup, it's a bit of a breakup album. Generally, it received good reviews from the critics. Metacritic added up all the different reviews and said it got a 76 out of 100, which gives it a B+. It did manage to get into Rolling Stone's top 500 albums, although just in the lower ranks. Brian Rowley from Consequence of Sound called Fine Line an airy, melancholy album that diplomatically addresses heartache while declining to wallow in it. So I suppose one of the other possible issues is the fact that it doesn't really offer a fresh perspective as to what Harry's particular style is. That could be something we might want to discuss later. Yep. Because it is quite derivative. And so depending on how you take that, it's probably going to affect the mood of what you think of the album.
Yeah, I tend to agree. When you first suggested this, I thought, oh, Harry Styles is the guy from One Direction. And maybe that tainted my listening of it. So the first three songs, all I heard were poppy, jazzy numbers from a boy band. It wasn't until I delved a little bit deeper that I got something more cerebral out of it. Maybe I'm looking too much into it. But I don't know, what do you think of the first three tracks? They were the big ones that everyone knows.
Oh, look, they are literally straight out of the pop music playbook. It's an album of two halves. We've got the first half, which is very poppy, easy to listen to, good to put off in the background. Then we've got the other half of the second side B, which is a little bit more different, a little bit more eclectic, and has some stuff that you can really, I guess, sink your teeth into and either really love or really hate. But I struggled to find any real Harry Styles in this album, yet I saw so many other influences of other artists. And I'm wondering, there are so many producers as well, if we're really getting their tastes rather than Harry.
How much was him and how much was written for him?
Well, he wrote all the songs, I believe.
Okay.
But there was a very big input from the various different producers. And I can see what you mean. There are lots of different styles going on there. And although I really enjoyed the album, I did also come away thinking that this is like somebody who is learning to be a musician artist when they're first learning. They're copying the masters. They're learning previous techniques and styles that have gone before their own emerging style. And I've got a feeling that this is what Harry Styles is doing. He's wearing his influences right up front, and you could say it's a bit derivative, but at the same time, some of the songs have got enough in there that makes me feel I really wonder what his next album is going to be like. This is an album with lots of potential.
I noticed his biggest inspiration for this album was David Bowie. However, there is actually very little in here that I saw like David Bowie.
I agree.
In an interview, he quoted Bowie, "Always go that little further into the water than you feel you're capable of being in. Go a little bit out of your depth. When you don't feel your feet are touching the bottom, you're just in the right place to do something exciting." Now, Styles quoted Bowie on that when he was talking about this album, which I found really interesting. But I wonder if he's just sort of...
not got out the wading pool.
No, he's still in... he's still in the shallows, I think.
Yeah.
I feel he's getting there. I would agree with you. I mean, for a breakup album, it's not sad enough. For a psychedelic album, it's not out there enough. Mm. It's a little bit of everything, and he's trying to see kind of what fits, I think. But I still think there's some indications that on certain songs, he's going to some pretty good places, and it's definitely, it's not pop for the masses. On side one, there's a few pop songs that are pretty mundane pop songs. But there again, there's quite a lot on there that is going in other directions. So I'm still eternally hopeful and would like to see what his third album is going to be like. And I think there's a lot of potential in this.
Ever the optimist. I can just echo a couple of things you guys said. For me, it tried a little bit too hard to be like other people, and therefore it sounds exactly like other people. I feel like I got a little bit bored. I was kind of hearing, wasn't necessarily the same thing, but it was other people's stuff. I will say this. He has a lovely voice. He's a good singer.
Yeah.
But his voice, I find a little bit high and flinty. So the things that he was singing didn't match the songs that he was singing. So... my favourite song on the album by far, and I think the best song on the album, was She. I thought, and I know you've got a different idea to me, Dave, but I thought that was a really soulful, deep, funky song. Someone singing their heart out about She. Love to hear it done by... like a R&B artist or something like that. But his voice just didn't really match. So he didn't resonate with me.
How would you have felt if that song maybe was sung by Chris Martin of Coldplay?
I'm not a huge Coldplay fan either.
I mentioned those two because that song, She, really sounds a bit like Yellow from Coldplay.
Oh, man, we heard different things.
Yeah. I know, because I was thinking, I was really picking up on the psychedelic side of She.
Wow.
I thought it was really John Lennon. Even he's got a bit of a nasally twang in the sort of opening
John
section.
Lennon.
That little bass line in there has that little Beatles-esque.
Any of the Beatles on this album, you can hear it. Did you pick up the sensual side of the album? An awful lot of it is referencing taste and touch and colour and feel. It's really, and I mean sensual, not necessarily in sexy, although a lot of the songs are kind of subliminally about sex. I mean, they say watermelon sugar is pretty much a metaphor for...
wow. Keep it PG, please.
For fun activities between consenting adults.
Right.
First side of the album I found was really quite sensual. There's lots of references to warm summer evenings and things. But with Golden, all the talk about the light and everything, I was there. I was in a Californian summer, late afternoon. The light is getting golden. And, you know, you're with a beautiful woman and her skin is gorgeous and everything. You know, I was right there with him. And he really sold it to me.
Wow. Well, it wasn't bad, but it wasn't my cup of tea. And I feel like with you two guys who know a whole lot more about music, that line of... not my cup of tea is going to come out a lot each week.
And that's the pleasure of this. Because hopefully, as time goes on, the listener will discover where our tastes lie. And that's one of those great joys of finding something you think, what Dave says is a whole load of twaddle. But I really agree with Chris.
Accurate.
Or Christian's really nailed that. I agree with Christian on these. Because we've all got different tastes.
Dave, was your favourite song?
Canyon Moon was the first one that sucked me in. When I first heard that, I just loved that retro 60s West Coast feel. I keep thinking back to the time under the canyon moon. sounded like Neil Young strumming on the guitar, maybe a bit of Fleetwood Mac in there. The melody was a Paul McCartney. It was sweet and beautiful, but after really listening to the album lots and lots of times, and I think this is an album that deserves listening to on headphones because there's so much more musicality in the album, but it's deep in the mix. It's not really right up front. But after listening a lot, it was Fine Line. That was the one that actually made my heart skip a beat.
Yeah.
When Fine Line starts off, that Bon Iver high falsetto vocal that he's got, it's very ethereal, folky, neo-folk music. Put a price on emotion. Looking for something to buy. And then it just builds and builds into this giant, majestic anthem, which you think is going to go places, and it doesn't. And so it's this delayed resolution that you get right at the end. I mean, once again, I'm getting almost orgasmic.
I did love those sort of wavy, you know, instrumental harmonies
in
that music. And that was pretty amazing. And it took me back to some of those really amazing sort of trippy Radiohead, to take you on that journey. But then to finish it with that brass, that big band almost sort of feel.
It just lifts. It goes a place you're not expecting.
Sorry, you guys are just going, oh, that was amazing, that was amazing. I wrote, could have done without the triumphant horns. Sounds like a mariachi. There you go, different tastes.
Let's get to the wine.
Okay, let's talk about the wine. Christian, lead us off with that big fat red over there.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't quite sure what to go with this, and I really thought, let's go with a white. Let's go with something that's sweet and I don't know, I guess maybe a little bit soulless, which is what maybe I thought the album was. But as I listened to it a little bit more, I actually went and changed the bottle that I bought. I found that this Zinfandel, it's creamy, it's smooth, it's chocolatey, and tiny bits of caramel and lots of berry. But what struck me with this particular wine is when I started reading some of those reviews on it, it was actually similar to those reviews that Harry has received himself. So it's a bit of a hit and miss. I found the wine has a greater depth to it than we really think that's there, that's missed by some people, depending on your taste in music or your taste in wine. Look, for me, this is a Californian album. You're driving, you know, topless car around the mountains on the coast road in California. Mm. Sun's in your hair, the wind's in your hair. Well, maybe not yours, Chris, but, you know, it's you are warm and you feel alive. I feel like you do when you drink this wine. Also, I guess a small side note, Harry has made his break into movies. The Francis Ford Coppola. Yeah,
he was in Dunkirk.
2017. He's also got a couple of other projects as well, which he's working on now as well. So,
yeah, right. Well, it smells fantastic. But I'm not going to drink mine just yet because I'm on this rosé. So this is a very light, summery number. We're a bunch of winos, so we probably know this. And if you are the listener, singular, you're probably a wino too, so you probably know this. But if we ever get any other listeners that aren't winos, rosé is not a blend of red and white wine, which is what a lot of people think. It's actually made from any kind of grape. Usually this one's made from pure Shiraz, which is usually a big, deep purple wine. When they crush it, they leave it on the skins for a matter of hours, and the skins leach out their colour into the wine to produce what you've got in your glass. This is watermelons. It's not necessarily sugar because it's quite dry, but it's definitely melony. And as soon as I drank it, it was strawberries and cream, which is pretty common for a rosé, which this is an inoffensive, easy-to-drink wine that will go down perfectly on a hot summer's day and you just don't need to think about it. But you can still enjoy it. And for me, that was this album.
I mean, looking at the label, looks like we've got a nice picture of the beach or the water. The sun is setting, watermelons and oranges and growing all around.
That colourful should be label. The album cover.
It should be that. So, well, yeah, actually, looking at the album colour, I mean, Harry is an interesting young man, and he's certainly got some ideas on fashion. Yeah, it's actually quite a unique sort of look that he has.
So I've got to ask, is anybody picking up the tuna brine that I'm getting from this?
In the nose, a little, just a little.
Tuna brine. I have not ever heard that used. And, but then, and, you know, if you can use pencil shavings, you can use tuna brine, I suppose.
When you first described it, I had my concerns. I didn't think this was going to be a wine for me. But I actually quite like it. It's not bad.
Yeah, me too.
You're right, flinty dry. But this is going down very smoothly. You're right, this is a drink for a Californian beach.
It's not as crisp or apple-y as some of the drier rosés, but it's certainly sweeter without being overly sweet, isn't it?
And it's definitely got that creaminess. I got that immediately. It's a bit, little bit thicker in the mouth, a bit more texture to it than a white wine or a light rosé. But the colour, it's very pale. It's
golden.
And it's from Golden Mile. Yeah. Be honest, we couldn't match it any better than this.
Well, that's not right off the zin just yet.
Well, no, I haven't even tasted it yet, so let's do that.
Okay, should we get into it?
Yeah. I mean, look at it. It looks beautiful, and I've got a bit of a bias towards Californian reds. My other choice this week would have been a Californian Pinot, but I do love a zin. Okay, so here's the big Zinfandel. What do you smell?
For me, it's smoke and spice.
Yeah, the spice is really up front. Christmassy spice. Star anise, I can smell in there. Dave, I think you said the cloves got you.
I was getting cloves. That smokiness gives it an almost a barbecue-y kind of flavour to it. And it's chewy. The fruit's coming through. It's got it all. It's got lots of different things going on in the glass in here.
It's not overly heavy, though. Even to look at it in the glass, I wouldn't say it is a deep colour. You can see the stem in the bottom of the glass, and I think for a zin, maybe that's a little bit interesting.
But you don't get the same spice when you taste it. It's there initially, but then it moves into something else. I don't know, for me, it moves into a creaminess, a smoky cheese.
Well, like a smoked cheddar or something.
Yeah.
Well, it's walking, dare I say, a fine line between a powerful zin, you know, what you'd expect from Zinfandel, and something a little bit lighter and a little bit different. There's a lot going on in the glass, both when you smell the bouquet and when drink it, rather like the Alp, there's a lot of different things happening here.
Yeah, I mean, but I would also argue this is a thinker. You can think about this wine and really take it apart. I couldn't do that with that album.
Not even some of the tracks towards the end, because I agree with what Christian said. It's upfront pop, and Watermelon Sugar is just a perfect
absolutely
pop song. The only trouble is being played to death. So now that sweetness that you get from that, it is a sweet pop song.
Yeah.
It's now sickly sweet because you've just heard it 100,000 times. But the second side of the album gets pretty eclectic. It's quite a mix of different sort of styles and different things going on there.
Yeah.
And there's some songs that you would not find. I mean, you said you felt boy band.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, no, this is
not towards the end.
This is actually trying to shake that off. I think the first half was. And then the second half, he's moving into new territory.
My favourite song of the album is Sunflower Volume 6. Sunflower, my eyes want you more than a melody. Let me inside. It's way out there. The bass line in that song is just fantastic. I was explaining to Dave off air that, you know, I hear Oompa Loompa songs from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory in it. And I also hear, like,
I want to listen to that, though.
Paul Simon. Paul Simon's in there as well.
I actually wrote his name down.
And the Banana Splits theme tune is where I go to
that
for that particular song. So, you familiar with the Banana Splits, Chris? Great TV show from the 70s. Feel good. And it just had that sort of vibe to me.
Okay. Maybe I'm a bit too dark. It was a bit too happy, clappy, hippie for me, which doesn't make it bad.
Yeah.
It's just not to my taste. I wanted a little bit more grit in my ears.
So for grit in your ears, what did you think of Fine Line? So
Fine Line was a little bit more serious, and I actually thought it's a sign of things to come. Again, didn't really like the mariachi end to it, but that is just my opinion. Although, in the middle, I wanted to mention this. I'm quite a big fan of the band Alt J. They're all really good musicians in their own, like, classically trained sort of musicians. And in the middle, I got a lot of that sort of stuff. That might be something to look at in the future.
I don't know the band, so I'll have to...
And, I've never heard of them.
Yeah.
And a bit of Angus and Julia Stone.
I was got Bon Iver very much at the beginning. And then for me, at the end, it was Elbow. It's nice that everybody listens to the same song. And everybody, maybe from our own point of reference and our own musical tastes, we then decide what it is we pull out and actually recognize.
Absolutely. That's the beauty of any art, I suppose, is that you get from it what you want.
So what about the glimpses of the little French glimpses that we have in the album as well?
Oh,
little,
Cherry, when he's got...
Yes, a little bit of Camille in there, I think. Is that her speaking on the album?
Yes, it is.
What did you say?
Speaks in French.
Who's she?
I think it's Camille Rowe.
Camille Rowe. Who's she?
That's his girlfriend. So Camille was his girlfriend. I don't think they're still together anymore.
No, they'd broken up quite a few of the
songs.
Is
she French?
Yes, she is.
She's French. I think she was a Playboy model.
And so the album, I mean, he described it's part breakup album and part sort of sex album.
All right.
And so the breakup is with Camille.
Okay.
There's lots of songs where he is singing about his relationship with Camille or other mystery people.
I mean, a breakup is musical gold, isn't it, really?
He's pretty frank with some of the stuff that he sings about. He's pretty open and honest. I'm in my bed, and you're not here, and there's no one to blame but the drink and my wandering hands. But he doesn't wallow in heartbreak.
Can I just put a little ad in for...
Yeah, go for it.
I want to try and sell you on the reason this rosé is the best match for this album. But I will just say this, I much prefer the Zinfandel, maybe because it's winter right now. Here's what I reckon. This wine is light, it's breezy, it's not very deep. It would probably appeal to the young masses if we're going on trend. Rosé is very popular with the youngsters. Easy to drink, fresh. Don't need to think about it too much. Not overly complex, but enough to enjoy it. And the album itself has some earwigs, so you'll remember it. It's not unremarkable, and it doesn't take itself too seriously. So for me, red wine was not a match, so I went with the rosé, the strawberries, the cream, the watermelon, the sugar.
Well, thanks, Chris. Yeah, it's a good summation of the Golden Mile. And look, I think the Golden Mile for me, the rosé, is just that little bit superficial. But if you want to dig a little bit deeper and you're prepared to get that shovel out, then maybe the Zin and maybe Harry is right for you, because there's layers in that Zinfandel. You know, there's that chocolate, there's that spice at the start, those anises, and there's also this deep, rich, creamy center that I think we're going to get to. And I think the album is a lot like that as well. It does start off, you know, a little bit spicy, a little bit boy bandy, but then it's a little bit deeper and a little bit richer in that second side of the album. There's certainly a lot there for you if you really want to dig into it. And that's why I think the Zin is going to do it for me.
Well, I've just realized I get the deciding vote.
Yeah, 100%.
You do.
So this is interesting. I agree wholeheartedly. I think your pitch was fantastic.
Talking to me, Dave?
I'm talking to you, Chris.
For the rosé.
I'm not a fan of rosé. Mm. However, I agree wholeheartedly with what you said and why you picked it, and I have enjoyed drinking it. For me, the album, there's a deeper core to it. I think there's a lot more music in there that you really need to put headphones on to listen to. There's so much going on. Sometimes it's deep down, but this wine, the Zinfandel, there's a lot going on in here. There's multiple flavors. It's not as deep and strong as some Zinfandels might be. So it's got that lighter note, which Harry, you know, he's pretty light pop. He's a pop musician.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it's the Zinfandel. This is a delicious wine.
Well, good thing for me that it comes down to points. So let's look at our points that we gave for each wine. So each of us is going to give a score out of 10 watermelons this week on how well each wine matches the album. Now, it doesn't mean that we like the wine more than the other. It just means that maybe one of them we thought individually was a better match for the album. So for me, the Golden Mile Rosé, the Australian Rosé, definitely was the winner for me. And I gave that 8 watermelons out of 10. And the Zinfandel, although I probably enjoyed drinking the Zinfandel a lot more than the rosé, I gave that 6 watermelons. What about you, Christian?
I agree. I think the Golden Mile was actually delicious, and is actually something I might look to buy myself. Look, I give it 7 watermelons out of 10.
That's for the rosé?
That's for the rosé. For the Zin, I really love this. And for me, I'll be getting this again. I'm going to give that 8 watermelons out of 10.
Okay, and I guess that comes back to you, David, the decider.
The Golden Mile Rosé, although I loved your pitch, for me, it is 6 watermelons.
Wow,
out of 10.
Ooh, no, fair enough.
I'm no messing around, and the Zinfandel was 9 watermelons out of 10, and that is matching to the album
Okay.
But also the Zinfandel was my favourite to drink.
Awesome. Where did you acquire that?
I bought this in Costco.
So for all our international listeners or American listeners, as if there are any, I don't know why.
Absolutely. I think. Yeah. Your mum, isn't it?
Yeah, this was $37.99 at Costco. I think about the price that you would want to pay. It is just that little bit more expensive, but it certainly drinks like a more expensive bottle of wine, I'd say.
Yeah, I would be happy to pay that price for that bottle. The rosé, this is interesting because that rosé was actually $25 a bottle. And look, we are here in Australia where rosé is pretty popular, and I think you can probably get really nice bottles of rosé for a little bit less than that.
Absolutely, about the $18 to $20 mark, aren't you?
But having said that, it is still really a nice bottle of rosé.
Yeah.
And on a hot day, it would be a perfect match. So, and you could probably pick that one up, the Golden Mile. You could get that anywhere. So, the result. So, for matching to Fine Line by Harry Styles, the rosé scored a whopping 21 out of 30 watermelons.
Wow. Pretty good.
Oh, yeah. But yeah, deserved.
The Zinfandel, however, took it out with 23 watermelons out of 30s.
Can I offer in another possible drink to have with this album?
Yeah.
It is a watermelon cosmopolitan.
Wow.
As we've already described, there's multiple styles on this album. We see a lot of different faces of Harry. I think a watermelon cosmopolitan, it's got a number of different aspects to it. So if you're going to drink this, what you want is one shot of watermelon-infused vodka. Very easy to do. Cut up some chunks of watermelon, stick it with some vodka, leave it for 5 or 6 days, and you'll have it. Then you want half a shot of Cointreau, half a shot of fresh lime juice, one shot of cranberry juice if you want to go for the more traditional cosmopolitan. If you want to really amp up those summer watermelon flavors and it's not too sweet, then you can actually just use watermelon juice, just strain it and use it instead of the cranberry. Shake it over ice in a cocktail shaker, and you have got yourself a cracking summer cocktail. Really beautiful. Pour it into a martini glass, put on Harry Styles' Fine Line, and you'll be having yourself
into oblivion.
Yes. Yeah. Great summer's day.
And the same token, if you're looking for a wine that you could also drink with that, I think you've got to go light, although my compatriots here would disagree with their choice. But rosé, it's a really, really popular wine these days. It's not always a warm weather drink, but does seem to go really, really well. It's super popular with the youngsters these days. Get yourself a bottle of rosé. There's plenty around. They're not all sweet. In fact, they're tending towards dry these days, most of them. They're serious wines.
Chris, where do they make the best rosé?
In the world, do you mean? Or?
Where would they grow them?
Well, in the fridge at the moment, I got one from Spain. It's actually 100% Grenache. And I thought this one was a little bit strange. 100% Shiraz, which I haven't often seen as a majority share. But if you talk to someone from France, they'll say they make the best rosé in Provence.
Mm.
If you talk to someone from Spain, they'll say they do it.
So the answer is just try lots of different wines from around the world.
I guess my one guiding factor would be decide whether you want a sweet wine or a dry wine.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the sweet rosé is cheaper and not overly pleasant, to my taste anyway. I like a really light, dry, French-style rosé, which can have some of that complexity that some of the cheaper varieties don't.
Just going on that, just talking about some of those sweeter rosés, I mean, how do they get them so sweet? Is that from the fruit being left on the vine for so long, or is that they adding sugar to it to get that sweetness?
There's a couple of ways that it can happen. So what you can have left over is something called residual sugar, which means they stop the ferment early. So they stop the yeast from turning the sugar into ethanol, which makes a lower alcohol wine, and then you've got sugar left over. So that's what they call residual sugar. So if you ever see there's a certain number of grams of residual sugar left in a wine, it gives you an indicator of how sweet it's going to be. Now, for a normal dry table wine, it's really quite low, so sort of less than 2 grams per litre. But if you're getting up high, I mean, I had one the other day, which was a Riesling, which was 26 grams, which is a really, really...
Wow, that'd be super sweet, wouldn't it?
Was that close to a dessert wine?
Yeah, it was sweet.
Yeah.
But that's the style that was made.
Yeah.
And just before everyone starts going, oh, a typical Riesling, Riesling's usually dry. So
yeah.
Australia has just copped it about Riesling because we used to make a lot of it, you know, 10 to 20 years ago. But dry Riesling's beautiful. Yeah.
We've had wine recommendations. So I was now going to ask for music recommendations. Somebody who does listen to this album, gets into it, thinks, oh, this is great, I love it, and maybe might want to try some more music. Where do you think they should go?
That's really interesting. I mean, because in this album, I see a lot of Coldplay, Beatles, Billie Eilish, Eurovision. There's so many different things in there.
I didn't get any of those.
I mean, if anyone's looking for something that's quite similar, you've got to look back into the 70s.
The back end, I got that California sound. I got America.
Okay.
Particularly in Canyon Moon.
Yeah.
I mean, also, what is that song about? He's never been in a canyon in his life.
No, he recorded it in...
In a canyon?
In Laurel Canyon California.
Maybe I'll just shut my big mouth.
Can we talk about how weird Treat People With Kindness is? Because what the hell's going on with that song?
It is a strange song.
It's a bizarre song. At the end of the album, it's very trippy. You ever seen those old 60s beach blanket bingos movies?
Oh, the old movies. Sort of Elvis ones.
Yeah.
It sort of feels like it's out of that. It feels like it belongs in one of those sort of cheesy movies.
I loved its joyous nature. I know for some people it would be twee, the hand claps and when the horn section comes in and he's screaming, you know, let's go, boys, or whatever he says. I don't think it's meant to be any deeper than that. It is exactly what it says, treat people with kindness.
Which is a lovely message.
It is.
It's just, again, I want some grit in my ears.
Okay.
Yeah.
Chris, you like the more psychedelic
side. Yeah.
What about Tame Impala?
I like Tame Impala,
And possibly the Beatles, but go for their most psychedelic album.
Yellow Submarine or
Magic Mystery Tour would have to be the album that will really, it's out there. There's a lot of acoustic guitar on here. I've already mentioned Neil Young. Fleetwood Mac, I think, would be, Rumours or something like that. There's an album called Echo in the Canyon, which is about those early 60s joining a folk and pop together. And it's about the Laurel Canyon days, all the American folk bands that were there, Crosby, Stills and Nash, the Mamas and the Papas, and those sorts of things. It's a Netflix movie that's on there, a documentary. And it's called Echo in the Canyon.
Yeah, right.
Oh. And it's made by Bob Dylan's son. He goes back and he talks to a lot of those bands or the aging members of those bands. And then they do a number of the most famous songs from that era. They do it in a more modern style, but they stay true to the songs. They're not reinterpreting them. It is a fabulous documentary. It's really worth catching. The album is terrific that goes with it. And there's actually a Spotify playlist that matches it and gives you the originals and then the new versions. So Echo in the Canyon, it's about those glory days of folk pop in Laurel Canyon, California.
Seems pretty specific, though. I mean, if you're really into your folk pop.
Okay, well, if you want to go more modern, if you want to go a bit more on the Harry Styles pop side, I'd be recommending Hozier, Generationals.
Take Me to Church.
But to recap, Harry Styles, Fine Line, not a bad album, I think is a good synopsis.
Yeah,
and both wines tonight, the Rosé and the Zinfandel, very, very nice, but the Zinfandel takes it. So it's good night from me, good night from Christian.
Good night from me.
And good night from Dave.
Good night.